Good morning. Welcome to MCC. If you're in the gallery getting some coffee, take your time. Come on in. And when you find yourself in the worship center, we welcome you to stand up and sing this song with us as we worship together this morning. Sing Jesus, what a Savior.
Jesus, what a Savior, what a brother, what a friend, the lifter of the lowly. God, you meet me where I am. Your heart, it knows no more. Knows no walls. You're constantly toward me with open arms. I've never known a love like yours. I've never known a love like yours. No, I've never known a love like yours. Never known love like yours. Sing Jesus, Jesus, what a Savior. What a brother, what a friend, lifter of the lowly. God, you meet me where I am. Your heart, it knows no borders, knows no constantly, and you're constantly moving toward me with open arms. I've never known a love like yours. I've never known a love. I've never known a love like yours. No. I've never known a love like yours. I've never known a love like yours. Sing hallelujah this morning. And hallelujah, hallelujah. What a beautiful way you've shown us. Hallelujah, hallelujah, what a beautiful Savior. Sing hallelujah. Prayer this morning. I've never known love like yours. No, I've never known love like yours. I've never known love like yours. Sing Jesus, what a Savior. And Jesus, what a Savior. What a brother, what a friend, the lifter of the lowly. God, you meet me where I am. Sing that one more time. Jesus, what a Savior. What a brother, what a friend, the lifter of the lowly. God, you meet me where I am.
Good morning. Welcome to MCC. My name is Anthony Vanderskaff, on staff here, and it is so good to be back worshiping with you all, whether you're online or in person. Right now, if you're comfortable with saying hello to the person next to you, or maybe a few rows over, say hello, make eye contact. I'm trying to do that with so many of you I haven't seen in a while, so say hello to each other. Sing this old song this morning, Eventide. It doesn't really have to do with as much nautical as you might think. It's the evening. It's the closing of the day. It's the closing of our lives. Our lives are a lot shorter than we might actually realize. Sometimes we're in our youth, and life can seem very long. Most of life is ahead of us. But if we stop and realize our mortality, and actually that God is with us in just this short life that we get to have, fast comes the eventide. And this is a recognition that our lives are very short, and we're grateful that God is with us and has been with us through all of it.
Abide with me, fast falls the eventide, the darkness deepens, Lord, with me abide. When other helpers fail and comforts flee, help of the helpless, abide with me. Thou on my head in early youth did smile, and though rebellious and perverse meanwhile, thou hast not left me, though I oft left thee. Unto the close, Lord, abide with me.
I need thy presence.
I need thy presence every passing hour. What but thy grace can foil the tempter's power? Who like thyself my guide and stay can be? Through cloud and sunshine, abide with me. I fear no foe with thee at hand to bless. Ills have no weight, tears lose their bitterness. Where is thy sting, death? Where grave thy victory? I triumph still, oh, abide with me. Thy cross before my closing days, shine through the gloom to your ways. Heaven's morning breaks and earth's faint shadows flee. In life and death, Lord, abide with me.
In life and death.
In life and death, Lord, abide with me. In life and death, Lord, abide with me.
Lord, thank you for abiding with us and being with us in your Son, Jesus Christ, and then giving the gift of the Holy Spirit, which we have just been sitting in the teachings and hopefully understanding more and more about relationship with you through the Holy Spirit. And Lord, even now, as we sit and maybe in some ways just kind of get into lecture mode and maybe we expect to be taught something new and fresh, open up our hearts and minds that even the old would be renewed and be made fresh, so that we wouldn't be so proud and so bold as to think that we can't learn something new from the old things that you have for us, but that things could be reignited and renewed in light of your Holy Spirit teaching and guiding us. So we pray this morning that you would soften our hearts and that you would guide us even in our learning and our teaching. And as we go from here, that we become more and more like you and be different than just good law-abiding citizens, that we would actually be light in the darkness. So we pray for Jim this morning. We pray for his words that are your words, using him as your instrument. And as we receive your teaching, shape us and mold us and guide us. We love you, God, and thank you for loving us first. Amen. You can have a seat.
And good morning, everyone. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Jim Boer. I'm the lead pastor here at MCC. And thank you for exceeding my expectations for a holiday weekend. I'm excited. We've got a lot going on here at MCC, but especially if you're new, you got to know that we consider ourselves on a mission here. And the mission is this: to love God, love people, and love the city. And in fact, you're not going to get out of here this morning without a little conversation about our next project to love the city, but we'll get to that at the end of the service. So thanks for being here, everyone. There are no children's ministries on 4th of July weekend here, so Kids Connect and Bible Bistro is off this morning, but we do have nursery if you need to drop your child off at the nursery. And as Anthony alluded to, we've been talking about the Holy Spirit. We're spending the whole summer trying to renew and recalibrate and re-engage our relationship with the Holy Spirit. Not our knowledge of the Holy Spirit. That's good, though. But it's more important to have a relationship with Christ through the Holy Spirit. Not our theology, though I love theology. I'll talk theology all day. But it's a relationship that we have with Christ through the Holy Spirit. So we've been at it for several weeks now. And we've talked about who the Holy Spirit is, how Jesus introduced the Holy Spirit to the disciples. And, you know, the Holy Spirit is the God who dwells in the middle of your life right now. What does the Holy Spirit do? We've talked about the Holy Spirit as our teller of truth, our spirit of truth, and our advocate. This morning, we're talking about some other works of the Holy Spirit. Now, I don't know if you've noticed this. Perhaps you have. But there are some verses in Scripture that lend themselves to being decorations. You know what I'm talking about? There are some verses in Scripture that, well, that's worth painting on a wall or putting in a frame and hanging in the foyer. Okay, here's one of them. 1 Corinthians 13. Love is patient. Love is kind. It's a beautiful passage. It's powerful words, and they just, there's a sentimentality, right? Here's another one, Psalm 46, verse, on a coffee mug. Yeah, be still and know that I am God. Now, we're going to talk this morning about the fruit of the Spirit, And the fruit of the Spirit is one of those that it's not unusual. I had a fruit of the Spirit. It was a beautifully crafted set of wooden blocks that hung in my office for years and years and years. So the fruit of the Spirit is one of those decorative verses. Now watch out, right? Not that that's bad. I'm not suggesting that in the least. There's no criticism there. But the thing about those decorative verses is that you can forget the context out of which they came. You know, that incredible 1 Corinthians 13 love passage is really in an ongoing and extended conversation that the Apostle Paul had with a bunch of proud people. A bunch of people that were constructing a spiritual hierarchy and who were getting proud about certain gifts and not about others, and Paul had to correct them. Love was the fix, the correction to the pride that had infected that spiritual community. Psalm 46:10, I mean, some of you know what happens just before that verse. The mountains fall into the heart of the sea, right? There's a primal chaos going on. Everything is shook up. Be still and know. Now here's a little quiz. What was Paul talking about when he shared this passage we're going to read this morning about fruit of the Spirit? Is he talking about being a good neighbor? A winsome witness? Building healthy, shalom-filled community? Hold on to your boots, folks. Here we go. Galatians 5, 16 through 26, as we continue our conversation on the Holy Spirit, and this week, the fruit of the Spirit, this is God's word for our lives, so lift up your heart. The Apostle Paul says this, "So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They're in conflict with each other so that you are not to do whatever you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, then you're not under law. The acts of the flesh are obvious. Sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions and envy, drunkenness, orgies and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of heaven. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, also known as patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking and envying each other." The word of the Lord, thanks be to God. So there you have it. The fruit of the Spirit arises out of a conversation Paul is having with the Galatians about spiritual warfare, about being holy people in an unholy world. Now, a few weeks ago, we talked about this. We talked about spiritual warfare. So let me circle back around. Let me remind you that the Bible, the history of teaching in the church, the Big C Church, the Church of Christ, and your experience confirms that we are under spiritual attack all the time. The Bible, church history, and our experience confirms what we are told, that we have three sworn spiritual enemies, and they never stop attacking us. The devil, the great liar. Remember, what lie of the devil are you particularly prone to? The world, the devil never stops lying. The world never stops tempting. And the flesh. Now that's what Paul is talking about in this passage. Paul is talking about spiritual warfare, but especially about the flesh. Now, what is the flesh? What's Paul talking about? You know, that word gets used often in Scripture. Jesus uses it, but it gets used in different ways. In the Bible, broadly speaking, the word flesh gets used really in a very literal way, where flesh means our physical bodies, our material selves. But it also gets used figuratively, and that's the way Paul is using it here. The flesh is also symbolic of that inherited inner fallenness. Okay? Another way of thinking about this, Scripture teaches that when we come to Christ, all of a sudden we have two selves. We have this old self, this fleshy self. And then we have this new self. And Paul is talking about the conflict that those two selves live in. You know, Augustine had his way of describing that inner fallenness. He talked about it as the soul curved in on itself. That fleshy self, that inherited fallenness that we have, is preoccupied with, well, frankly, itself. It's that self-reliant, self-sufficient, self-satisfying, self-protective part of who we are. It's the soul curved in on itself, you see. So the flesh is that part of us that says, I can do it. I can handle it. I can make my own way. This is my life. I can forge my own destiny. Let me discover my own path. The flesh says, maybe you might need a spiritual crutch, but not me. Let me ask you, do you see any of the flesh in your own spirit? Do you see any of that inner fallenness in your own life? Of course you do. We all do. So Paul, in talking about the fruit of the Spirit, wants us, first of all, to reckon with the flesh, to know what it is. But in this passage, he tells us how the flesh works. There's a word here that I think it's so powerful and instructive. In verse 16, Paul says this, "So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh, for the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh." That word for desire is such a eye-opening word. It's the word in Greek, epithumia. Epithumia. A lot of older translations, you know, we've had trouble translating it. They've translated it as the word lust, but that got so over-sexualized that it began to lose its impact. Epithumia, our translators use the word desire, but I wonder. Here's the word. Epi, it's a compound word in the Greek. Epi really means over, beyond. When you put epi in front of something, it accelerates it. And the word thumia is the Greek word for passions or emotions or desires. So these desires aren't just desires, they're epi-desires, they're over-desires. And what Paul is telling us is that the desires of the flesh, the engine of the flesh, is over-desire. It's excessive, disproportionate, exaggerated desire. Now think about this. Think about what Paul is telling us. Think about how many of our faults and follies are just a good desire that gets epied. Right? Okay? Think about this. Acceptance. Acceptance is a natural human desire. It's good to seek acceptance. It's good to seek community and connection. But what happens if acceptance gets epied? Accelerated. Well, all of a sudden, you're hanging out with the wrong people. And you may be even doing the wrong kind of things to get accepted. So that epi-desire, that epithumia, takes acceptance, ramps it up, and creates a mess. Think about, you can do this with a lot of other things. Here's one. Think about justice. justice. Justice is a good thing, right? Justice is, we're called to be people who are just, but what happens when justice gets epithumia'd? All of a sudden you find yourself hating your enemy and seeking to destroy them. You see what happens? You see how that fleshy part of us, that epithumia part of us? Now, you heard that X-rated list that Paul is kind of famous for. He can rattle off a list of sins like no one else. And it's really overwhelming. Now, why does Paul do that? I'll tell you why he doesn't. He doesn't do it so that we can point a finger at other people and say, see, there it is. There's epithumia. You know why he does it? So you can look at yourself and so I can look at myself and say, there it is in me. Where does the epithumia, the overpassion, the over desire of the flesh, take you and me? Now that's the bad news. Paul wants to know that that's ground zero for the internal part of spiritual warfare. I suppose all of it's internal, but this one especially, it's ground zero for the battle we have with our own fallen selves. That's the bad news, but here comes the good news. Are you ready? You heard him say it. The Holy Spirit crucifies the flesh and grows spiritual fruit in our spirits. The Holy Spirit takes this, quite frankly, enslaving power of the old self and breaks it. You know, Augustine had a very interesting way of talking about the progression. He says, you know, in the garden, it was passe peccari, possible to sin. After we sinned, it was non passe, non peccari. It was not possible not to sin. We were slaves to sin. But now, in Christ Jesus, through the Holy Spirit, it's passe, non peccari. It's possible not to sin. We're free, right? This is why we believe people with addictions can break free and get sober, and people can change. And then at the end, when Christ comes and all the new creation, it'll be not non passe peccari, it'll be not possible to sin anymore. Sin will be gone. But what Paul is saying here is that the Holy Spirit has crucified that part of ourselves, and now in place of it is doing a transformative act of growing spiritual fruit in us. And I want to spend some time this morning just reflecting on the fruit of the Spirit. And I really want us to be aware of three things about the fruit of the Spirit. Number one, it's a gradual work. Number two, it's a radical work. And number three, it's a cooperative work. So let's talk about this, gradual. Anybody who has ever done any kind of planting or gardening or farming knows this, right? Healthy growing takes time. I mean, you don't just put a seed in the dirt and water it and poof, you know, that's for magic beans, not for real life seeds, right? No, what you need to plant. And then over time, you need to cultivate. And only when you've taken the time to plant and cultivate do you harvest. The fruit of the Spirit is gradual. And I find this absolutely remarkable. And probably one of the biggest challenges of our spiritual lives. Let me explain. Let's go back to that list that Paul mentioned. You heard it. Sexual immorality, impure, debauchery, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, discord. That's all ugly stuff, right? Wouldn't you think that God would want that out of your life, my life, our relationships, our families, our cities, our world? Wouldn't you think that God would just want to take that stuff and toss it out and zap it and immediately replace it with love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control? And yet it doesn't happen in a snap, does it? Let me prove it to you. Anybody in this room been a Christian for more than 20 years? 20 years, 20, 30 years, 40 years, 50 years. I want to talk, okay, 50-year people. Let's talk to you a minute. How's your spiritual life going these days? Are you the whole package? Are you fully Christ-like yet? Isn't it amazing? We still have a lot of growing to do. I mean, you'd all say that, right? Would you say amen to that? That even though I've been at it 50 years, I'm not there yet. I find that remarkable. That God is so patient with growing spiritual fruit in us. Let me tell you a couple things about that. Number one, the world finds that problematic as well. What's the most popular, constant, and repeated criticism of the church and Christians, people like you, that you people are hypocrites? Of course we are. Margaret Feinberg, in one of, just one of, she writes all kinds of great stuff. She was talking about that hypocrite, that finger pointing at Christians, and really at her, calling her a hypocrite. And she said this: I thought that becoming a follower of Jesus would help me kick the sin habit, right? That God would just sweep the bad out and replace it with good. But in some ways, my symptoms grew worse, she said. I realized how much I was infected and how it was affecting my attitude, my relationships, my life. So the truth is, I'm fighting. I'm fighting sin with everything I got, and some days I fare better than others. Odds are, if you're calling me a hypocrite, you caught me on one of my bad days. But then she continues, I'm sorry. I'm sorry I let you down and disappointed you, but I'm not giving up or letting go. I've encountered a God who promises the battle ends in victory, life instead of death. So call me crazy, but I'm holding on to that promise. Okay? Yeah. Now let me say this. This is the gradual part of our spiritual transformation is problematic to people looking at the church and expecting us to be better. But you know what else it's problematic? When we look in the mirror. Because I expect myself to be better. And my hunch is you do too. And just a couple weeks ago, I was talking in the back with someone, and we were talking about the struggle with sin, the battle with sin. You know, I'm a pastor. Shouldn't I know better? Shouldn't I be better? I think there's a version of this. Do you ever get, are you ever a little shocked that you're not more holy than you are? Are you ever a little dismayed at the battle that you have to fight? Here's the thing. And this is really important. So if you forget everything else I say this morning, don't forget this. Don't fret if you're in the battle, okay? Don't fret if you're struggling with sin. Don't fret if that struggle has been around for a long time. That does not mean you're not indwelt with the Spirit. In fact, if you are struggling with your sin, that's a sure sign that you are indwelt by the Spirit, because struggling with sin is not the problem. Battling sin is not death. You know what death is? Serenity in sin. See, it's when your conscience doesn't bother you anymore. That's the problem. It's when you're completely at peace with stuff you know is wrong. That's the problem. Then you're in a state of spiritual death. I think there are a lot of Christians who have this inner battle with themselves. They're quietly saying, I should be better. I'm not a good Christian. I'm a phony. I still have all these problems in my life. We talked about this last week, right? This is the freedom of the gospel. You know what you do with your sin battle? You give it to Jesus, and then you claim your forgiveness, your radical forgiveness. You're free. And then walk free. And then keep walking in that free. That's what Margaret is trying to talk about, is clinging to that promise. Stop trying to be good. That sometimes, I think, stimulates the fleshy part of us. Just live in the full forgiveness of Christ and keep repenting that stuff until the Spirit gradually grows that fruit in place. Are you with me this morning? You know? Okay. Just everybody take a deep breath. It's okay not to be okay. And maybe I'm just talking to myself. So the fruit of the Spirit is gradual. But the fruit of the Spirit is radical. Now, what am I talking about? You've probably heard preachers like me mention this before. If not, woo, great. Paul did not say fruits of the Spirit. He said fruit of the Spirit. Singular, not plural. Now, what does that mean? All those things, can we back up one slide, Sarah? All those things we see on that, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, that's one fruit. That's not nine different fruits. So you can't say, oh man, love is, I've got a lot of love. But no, this is one fruit that Christ, through his Spirit, is growing in you. Now here's the deal. This makes this radical, okay? Jesus didn't come, and he hasn't sent his Spirit into your life to kind of tweak your character and to improve your weaknesses, okay? Christ came to radically transform your life. Christ came to make you a new creation. C.S. Lewis in Mere Christianity puts it this way. He says, improvement is not redemption. God became human to turn creatures into sons and daughters, not simply to produce better people of the old kind, but to produce new men, new women. It's not like teaching a horse to jump better, but better, more like turning a horse into a winged creature. Now, do you hear this? Okay. We talked about this earlier in the, you know, a lot of times we struggle with the Spirit because we're treating the Spirit like our personal assistant. And because, quite frankly, there's a part of us that loves just a little improvement. Because spiritual transformation is hard. But that's not the point. Jesus sends the Spirit to radically transform our lives. Old school preachers had a couple words for this. They called this tension, this transformation, mortification and vivification. You see, there's a putting to death part of this. There's a on the cross with Christ part. Paul says it. The Holy Spirit comes to crucify that epithumia flesh of us. That's the mortification. We're putting to death. But then there's this vivification, this bringing to new life, this new self. And that's what Paul is talking about, this fruit, this one single radical transformation. How's that going? Takes time, remember. It's a gradual radical change. And then lastly this, it's cooperative. It's cooperative. I used that word last week, and I'm lobbying for you when it comes to your Holy Spirit thinking and relationship to keep that word close at hand, because that's our role. Our role is to cooperate. Remember last week with the fan? Maybe some of you weren't here. If you want to hear that sermon, I'm preaching it again this afternoon at City Hope, 5 p.m. You can join us. But we don't have to generate the wind. That's the Holy Spirit. We don't generate the power, but we get into the wind. We unfurl our sails into the wind. We cooperate with the wind. Every good sailor knows you can't sail unless you cooperate with the wind. You can't walk with Christ without cooperating with the Holy Spirit. And that's why Paul says in this passage, and this is where we pulled the whole title for this series that we have all summer long, in step with the Spirit. Paul says, keep in step with the Spirit. All he's asking you and me to do is cooperate. Cooperate. And there's two ways that you got to cooperate, that we cooperate. The first cooperation you have to do is you have to do this as an individual person. Okay? You, me too, we have to claim personal responsibility for our own spiritual lives. Okay? Nobody's going to read your Bible for you. I wrote that down this morning, but I said, you know, there are actually apps that will read the Bible for you. But you have to click on it, right? But nobody's going to say your prayers for you. And nobody's going to use your gifts for you. And you have to just do something. You have to be into this relationship with the Holy Spirit. Now, how do we cooperate with the Spirit? We've talked about all kinds of ways. Reading your Bible is one of them. Praying, getting in community, using your gifts. That's next week. We're going to talk about these incredible gifts of the Spirit. But you have to do it individually. And one of the things, you know, when you get with pastors, you know, pastors, we talk about, actually we grumble a lot. Maybe all professionals do that when they get together. One of the things we grumble about is, you know, the biblical illiteracy of people in the pew. Really what we're talking about is that there's just too much passivity. There's too many people just, you know, you kind of come to church on Sunday and then the rest of the week there's no spiritual activity. Let me tell you, I'll speak for all pastors. We would love to have coffee or sit down or even teach classes about helping people stay engaged. The Christian history, this is what we call the spiritual disciplines. Every single classic, historic, and new spiritual discipline was constructed so that throughout the week we would stay engaged in this relationship with Jesus through the Holy Spirit. Okay? But you got to do it. I can't do it for you. There's just no amount of waving my hands and pounding pulpits that's going to matter if you and I don't do it, okay? And then secondly, there's also a corporate version of this. Jesus didn't just create a bunch of cowboys, you know, individualists who are out there doing their own thing. He created a church. We have to do things together. This is one of them. Worship is one of them. Let me tell you, I'm going to read a quote here in a minute, and it absolutely, my whole heart and spirit believes everything that's true about this quote. Even in the most boring Sunday service, spiritual transformation can happen. The Holy Spirit, we should not dare to underestimate the mystery and the power and the beauty and the faithfulness of the Holy Spirit. Now, let me tell you this. We're trying to be the church. I've been around a few years now, but it's tough to be the church right now. I think the church, our public kind of face, our reputation is kind of on the low ebb. You know, there are a lot of people that are absolutely disgusted with the church. And you know, I think every now and then for good reason, not always, but sometimes. So it's so important that we come together as a church to be the church, to be these Spirit-filled communities, and to encourage one another in this gradual, radical transformation of who we're becoming in Jesus Christ. But it takes some faith. Eugene Peterson wrote, it's one of his shortest books. He wrote a lot of books, but it's a little book called The Wisdom of Each Other. And I've read to some of you portions of this book over the years. It's absolutely a fabulous book. And in the book, Peterson, it's an exchange of letters. It's letters he writes to his friend Gunnar, who after decades of rejecting the church and Jesus is trying to find his way back into the church. And he's kind of coaching him through some of the ups and downs. There are sometimes Gunnar is on fire, but Gunnar's about ready to quit church again. And this is what Peterson writes. May we all have a loving friend like this. Here you're back at it, Gunnar. Second-guessing God's way of being. You've had a lot of arguments with God over the years, and tell me, have you won any of them? Why not give up on this one too? And just let God do it his way. The church is not a natural community composed of people with common interests. I always like to ask, you know, when would you hang around with any of these people? Only in church. That's because the Holy Spirit's at work. The church is not a natural community. It's a supernatural community. And the super does not mean that it exceeds your expectations, but that it's other than your expectations. And then this quote, here it comes. Trust me, there's a lot more going on than you can guess. Go back to the company of those 70 or 80 people on Sunday. Listen believingly to scriptures read and preached. Offer your prayers. Receive Jesus in the sacrament. Bless your neighbors and wait for the kingdom. It's the Holy Spirit's style to fashion holy lives among the inept. Sorry if I insult you. But we've got to do this together, you know. And it's been hard to be together over these years. And we're learning new ways of being together. Now we're together online and we're together in person. But any togetherness, we'll take any togetherness because that's where the Spirit works. So, the fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit. What's your takeaway this morning? Don't be too disappointed if you're not there yet. It's a lifelong journey. But cooperate. Open your arms and your hearts to what the Holy Spirit is doing and will continue to do in you. And then marvel. Marvel. Marvel at the mystery that's present even in a little church like this. Hallelujah. Let's pray. So Jesus, Savior, friend of sinners, send the Spirit. Send the Spirit again and again and again. Send the Spirit to us when we're sitting in our chairs reading our Bibles. And send the Spirit to us on a Sunday morning like this when we gather together to know you and experience you and deepen our relationship with you. Send the Spirit so that we may be gradually but radically transformed. Come, Holy Spirit, give us cooperative spirits and grow that fruit. Change us into the likeness of Jesus Christ that we may be people of love and joy and peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Wow. Does that ever sound good? Only you can accomplish it. Come, Holy Spirit, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So Jesus said, I am the bread of life. I was reflecting on that this week. I'm the bread of life. He didn't say, hey, I'm a great encourager. Listen to my podcast. And he didn't say, hey, I'm a good teacher. Sit down, take notes. I mean, think about this. I am the bread of life. I will nourish your spirit and life. New life, my life, resurrection life will come to you. At this table, we come for the bread of life, the bread which we break. This is our participation, our communion in the body of Jesus Christ. The cup for which we give thanks, this is our participation, our communion with the blood of Jesus Christ. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. Hallelujah. Please pray with me. Loving Father, send now the Holy Spirit to settle on this bread and cup and fill them with the fullness of Jesus Christ. Do this, Holy Spirit, by the mystery of your faithful, loving presence. And as we take this bread and cup, Holy Spirit, settle on us. Convert us and all our epithumias from the pattern of this world and make us more like the pattern and the person of the one of whose table we now share. Shape us into the likeness of Jesus Christ, and do this, Lord, so that people may know that Jesus indeed is the Savior of our hurting and broken world. In His name we pray. Amen. And invite our servers to come forward at this time. At MCC, we come to the table every week. And that's been a wonderfully transforming worship practice for us. We realize that on any given Sunday, some of us are ready to come to the table and some of us aren't. If you are ready to come, then we invite you to come with gladness to the table of the Lord. And if today is not your day, then you are free to remain behind. Nobody will look at you cross-eyed, or there's certainly no pressure here. This table is freely offered, and we want it to be freely received. But let me say this. Christ created this table for people like us, broken people, needy people. People who need forgiveness can be assured of it here. People who love Jesus a little bit but want to love Him a whole lot more, come to this table, be nourished by His life. Come, let's remember the story of our salvation, how Christ gave Himself for us. Come, let's be nourished by His risen life. Come, be set free by His forgiveness and the promise of His Spirit. People, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Please come forward as you are ready.
I need You to soften my heart and break me apart. I need You to open my eyes to see that You're shaping my life. And all I am, I surrender. Give me faith. Trust what You say, that You're good and Your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give You my life. I need You. Soften my heart and break me apart. Oh, I need You to pierce through the dark and cleanse every part of me. And all I am, I surrender. Trust what You say, that You're good and Your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give You my life. I may be weak, Your Spirit's strong in me. My flesh may fail, my God, You never will. 'Cause I may be weak, Your spirit's strong in me. My flesh may fail. My God, you never will. Give me faith to trust what you say. That you're good and your love is great. I'm broken inside. I give you my life. Give me faith to trust what you say, that you're good and your love is great. I'm broken inside. I give you my life.
As we sing that again, I invite you to stand and sing with me. Give me faith.
Give me faith to trust what you say, that you're good and your love is great. I'm broken inside. I give you my life. Give me faith. Trust what you say, that you're good and your love is great. I'm broken inside. I give you my life.
At this time, if you are feeling in a place where you're not feeling obligated or not feeling out of a place of compulsion to give of your gifts to love the city, love people, love God through your gifts, your financial gifts, there's ways you can do that. You can give them in the big coffee cups in the back, they're at all the pillars, or online or through Venmo. Again, we give out of gratitude and to be marked as a people of generosity. And for no other reason other than that we have the Spirit saying, hey, like, there could be something that works even through something as simple as finances. Spirit works through relationship in our lives to help those around us and change our community. So if you feel that you're at a place that you can give financially, please do so now. We're going to sing this last song. And then we're going to go about our week, and we're going to receive a blessing in a minute from Jim, and then a few announcements as well. But I just want to invite you, even now, maybe resolve to take a few of those steps that Jim mentioned about leaning into Scripture, even just for a few minutes a day, maybe just contemplative prayer, and maybe see this week how it might shape and form you, not shame you. There's no shame.
What gift of grace is Jesus, my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold. My hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to Him. And oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me.
The night is dark,
but I am not forsaken. For by my side, the Savior, he will say, I labor on in weakness and rejoicing, for in my need his power is displayed. To this I hope, my shepherd will defend me. Through the deepest valley he will lead. Oh, the night has been won, and I shall overcome, yet not I, but through Christ in me. No fate I dread, I know I am forgiven. The future sure, the price it has been paid. For Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon, and he was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I hold, my shepherd, Jesus now and ever is my plea. And oh, the chains are released, I can sing, I am free, yet not I, but through Christ in me. With every breath I long to follow Jesus, for he has said that he will bring me home. And day by day I know he will renew me, until I stand with joy before the throne. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to him. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. Yet not I, but through Christ in me.
Folks, just take a seat. You'll be more. I'm not long, but we have a few things to talk about. This afternoon at 5 p.m., many of you know, some of you don't, but last fall, Monroe Community Church planted a church, City Hope GR, a church for individuals and families of all abilities. City Hope really has been inclusive of individuals and families who are trying to live with disabilities. They meet here in this building, in this space, at 5 p.m., and their pastor, Pastor Dave, who's a friend of ours, is just returning from Israel. So Jim and Anthony are going to take the privilege of being there, and we want to invite you. What a great opportunity. I know this is exactly what you had planned for your Sunday afternoon, but it is a privilege for us to encourage City Hope. They're a growing young church, and I find that exciting. I mentioned Love the City. Our next project is underway. We are loving the city by collecting groceries and other items for Matthew's House. Matthew's House is a ministry we've supported in the past. If you want to know anything about Matthew's House, Gord, raise your hand. Gord volunteers there every week, and the need has increased, people. They're low, so this is why we step in and do this. So if you don't get our newsletter, I want to encourage you to do that. You can get it through our website, mccgr.org. You can sign up and read it right from there. But we'd love to be supporting Matthew's House for the weeks ahead. Next Sunday is our second Sunday, and during the summer, we're doing our picnics in the park. So it's a new just our next time of our summer connections. Anthony and I are going to be co-opting the picnic in the park because we want to keep talking about Alpha. We have got such big plans for Alpha in the fall, and now's the time that we are recruiting our Alpha teams. Our dream is to have two teams that will run an adult Alpha out of their homes and another team who will join me in doing a youth Alpha, which we did with great impact a few years ago. We'd love to have that conversation with you. If you want to talk to me or Anthony about anything Alpha, but just know that we are starting to get people's names on the sheets to get people signed up. A pastoral note. Bob Ritzma is with us this morning. Bob said goodbye to his mom, and he's been taking care of his parents for years. There's a visitation Thursday evening from 6 to 8 at the Heritage Funeral Home on Lake Michigan Drive, and the funeral is 10:30 Friday morning at LaGrave. And Bob, we love you, and we support you, and Bob's been an example of extraordinary selfless love, so thank you for that, Bob. Now, I was asked to share one other thing, and I'm in a good mood, and I'll tell you why. I got this shirt this week, Grandpa Level Unlocked. So, Shell and I were able to, our oldest son, Kyle and Natalie, who many of you know were members of Monroe for many years, had their first child, and we're excited about it. So please ask one of us to show you pictures. We've got hundreds. Boy, a little boy, Leo James, 7 pounds, 1 ounce. So Leo James Bohr. I'm Grandpa Bohr, and I can't believe it. So, hey, folks, like I said, the Holy Spirit does things in our midst. I think the Holy Spirit does certain things only when we're in community. And if the Holy Spirit's been at work in your life this morning, our prayer team is always on standby in the prayer alcove. Please let us surround you and pray with you if you need any support or counsel at all. Okay, it's time to go. It's time to receive Christ's blessing. Please stand. And remember what Jesus said. In the world, you will have trouble. But Christ also said, take heart. I've overcome the world. He said, my peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, give I unto you. Don't let your hearts be troubled. Neither let them be afraid. Go in peace. Have a great holiday, everyone.
Congratulations.